titer testing dogs versus vaccination. Does one really replace the other? Isn't it easier just to vaccinate your dog when your vet advises? Or is this approach actually really harmful? Well, in this video, I'll discuss just why you might want to consider titer testing for your dog as an alternative to vaccination and what the titer test blood results really mean. Hi, I'm Dr. Alex from ourpetshealth.com, helping you and your pet to live a healthier, happier life. So if that's something you're interested in, consider subscribing and hitting that bell notification below. Dog vaccinations have had a massive impact on the health of our pet dog population, making previously ubiquitous and deadly diseases like parvovirus and distemper much less common. If you vaccinate your dog and live in an area with a high vaccine uptake, then chances are that your vet may hardly ever see these infections. If you want to know more about why your dog should be vaccinated and what diseases they should be protected against, then check out my guest video over on McCann Dogs that I'll link up here and down in the description below. For now though, let's say your puppy has had their initial vaccination course, finishing at around 16 weeks of age. When should you get them vaccinated again? Well, standard recommendations for our core vaccines would be to have a booster vaccine at 6 to 12 months of age, and then every 3 years after this to guarantee that they remain protected. Our non-core or lifestyle vaccines, by contrast, typically need to have a booster administered every 12 months for our dogs to maintain their immunity. If we want to take an individual tailored approach to vaccination, however, we can instead consider blood antibody titer testing dogs instead of vaccination. So this works by measuring the number of antibodies in the blood and using this as a guideline of a dog's immune status, so whether they are immune or whether they are still susceptible to disease. As a rough summary, when a dog is vaccinated, one way the body responds is by producing something called antibodies. So these antibodies are special proteins that recognize the vaccine bug and help the body to fight the infection. You might then think that simply if there are lots of antibodies, then a dog will be immune, and if there are a few antibodies, a dog will be susceptible to infection. Well, unfortunately, it is not this simple. The immune system is very complex. For most of our lifestyle or non-core vaccines, such as canine cough, kennel cough, leptospirosis, parainfluenza, and Lyme's disease, antibodies do not give us an indication of immunity. High antibody levels may be found in dogs who are immune, as well as those who are susceptible to the disease, as well as those that are actually infected with the disease at the time of blood testing. Low antibody levels are exactly the same. Some dogs will be protected and others will be susceptible to catching that infection. So this means that for our non-core or for our lifestyle vaccines, revaccination at the specified interval, which is often annually, is the only way to ensure that your dog remains protected. Antibody titer testing dogs is of no benefit for these diseases. The situation is different when it comes to the diseases that our core vaccines protect our dogs against, namely parvovirus, distemper, infectious hepatitis or adenovirus, as well as rabies. With these diseases, a high antibody titer test generally means that your pet is highly likely to be protected against the disease being tested for. Notice that I said highly likely, not definitely. All lab tests have some degree of error. And with vaccine titer tests, this error may mean that, depending on the exact test run, there may be a false positive rate of around 8 to 9%. So this means that for every group of 12 dogs thought to be immune due to a positive antibody titer test, one dog will actually not be immune or should have tested negative, and so may still be susceptible to infection. Let's move on to what a negative test result actually means when we titer test dogs. From the explanation I've already gone through, it would make perfect sense that if antibody levels drop below a certain amount, then a dog will simply become susceptible to the infection. Unfortunately, or actually perhaps fortunately for your dog, this is not always the case. And this is because there are parts of the immune system which actually act as almost like a memory center. When these detect that the bug they have been programmed to remember is present, they may be capable of really kick-starting the body's immune system back into gear and fighting the infection perfectly successfully, even when antibody levels were testing low. This doesn't always happen though, and low antibody levels may mean that a dog is no longer immune to the disease. The only way to know for sure would be to try and infect them with the disease and see if they got sick, which is obviously not something to be recommended because these are generally deadly diseases that we're protecting against. So a positive result is really likely to mean that your dog is immune, although it isn't an absolute guarantee, and a negative result means that your dog may or may not be immune. So if after all this, you know that you would not vaccinate your dog if they had a high titer test, when should you get your dog titer tested? Well, we can be pretty confident that after the initial vaccination program, a dog will be immune for at least 3 years. A very small number of dogs though will be what is known as non-responders and they'll never respond to vaccination. To know if your dog is a non-responder or not, you can consider titer testing them at about 24 weeks old or at least 2 weeks after their initial vaccinations. That done, the next titer test should be done at the next time your dog is said to be due a core vaccination. If they are positive, then you can think about skipping their vaccination. The next question then is, when should they have their next titer test? Well, that is not so simple. We know that some dogs will be protected for 5, 7, 9 years or even longer following vaccination. Having a positive titer only tells us that a dog is likely to be immune at that point. It doesn't tell us how fast this antibody level is falling, and so we're unable to predict just when the titer test will fall below that level needed to guarantee protection. This means that in general, it is recommended that a titer test is carried out every 12 months to reassess the need for vaccination in your dog. We need to be aware though that this may mean that there may be a period of many months when the titer is low and your dog is no longer protected from disease, or they may no longer be protected from disease. Although this is unlikely to be a common issue that results in serious disease, we just can't tell for sure. Rabies is a different matter though. In many cases, vaccination is required by law, and titer tests are often not always accepted as a substitute for vaccination. You will need to talk to your vet to find out what the specific requirements and legislation is where you live. So I told you it wasn't simple as you may have been led to believe. So why then go through the whole process of getting your dog titer tested instead of vaccinated? Well, the simple reason for this is that there is a risk of side effects with vaccination, but are dog vaccine side effects really that serious and common? Well, the simple answer is no. For the tremendous majority of dogs, vaccination is incredibly safe, and vaccine reactions requiring treatment are very uncommon. Vaccines, they effectively trick the body into thinking it has become infected and needs to mount an immune response. If you have been vaccinated, then you'll know that for a day or two, you might be feeling a little bit under the weather, and our pets are just the same. They might be a bit quiet, they might be less active, they might sleep more, and they might go off their food. The effects though are generally mild, if at all, and they're soon back to normal without any need for treatment. A very small number of dogs will get more severe reactions that require treatment. And the list of potential serious reactions is long, and they can sound scary, but it must be remembered that the actual risk of developing any of these is really very, very tiny, and the actual link between them sometimes is really not as certain as some people would make you believe. Ultimately though, you need to decide which course of action you're most comfortable with. Do you titer test and accept the limitations of this route, along with the small risk that this approach may expose your dog to infection? Do you instead vaccinate when advised by your vet? And again, accept the small risk that this may expose your dog to side effects. Which route you choose is up to you. Cost as well may also be a factor in the decision for you, so you should discuss this with your vets. I know where I am in the world, titer testing is significantly more expensive than vaccination, and so it's not something that many people are interested in. And this may or may not be the case where you live. You could of course simply choose not to vaccinate your dog after the initial course and hope that your dog is one of those who is immune for a very long period of time. I obviously believe that this is by far and away the most risky approach. These diseases, they are real, they are deadly, and they are likely to be very much a risk in your area. So I'd always recommend that any of my clients and canine patients to be vaccinated, given what we know at this point in time. Now, I know this might all sound very complex, and I've tried to make it as easy to understand as possible, but the immune system is a very complicated beast. As with most things in pet health, while it'd be great to have a clear black and white rule, the reality often means that decisions, they're more complex and more nuanced than that. Which is the best strategy for you and your dog? I'd love to hear your comments down below and your take on the subject. Remember, if it's your first time here, to subscribe to make sure you don't miss out on my future videos. And until next time, I'm Dr. Alex from Our Pets Health, because they're family.